You are listening to the audio production of Co-Piloting, Luck, Leadership, and Learning That It's All About Others, Our Story, by Jim Haslam and John Driver, published by Forefront Books. This book is read by Bob Kesling. Dedicated to the senior leadership team of Pilot Company and our 28,000 team members who serve others with excellence every day. All proceeds from the sale of this book will benefit nonprofits that support small business, entrepreneurial, and community-based ventures so that, like Jim Haslam, others may also be afforded the chance to be fortunate in their own unique endeavors. In memory of team members, Denise Nibby, Nettie Spencer, Joyce Whaley, of the Strawberry Plains Travel Center, you will never be forgotten. Foreword by Bill Haslam. I'm a little biased, but I think the story before you is unique, inspirational, and often hilarious. You should also know that it's been written against the will of its author. You don't see that every day, I know. But then again, you don't meet many people like my dad every day. As you will soon learn, Jim Haslam hates to talk about himself, so there was no way he was going to write about himself. His interests lie in many other places. His beloved wife, Natalie, his family, his faith, his community, his church, his alma mater, his endeavors in politics and philanthropy, and last but certainly not least, the company he founded and the tens of thousands of employees, or team members as Dad insists they always be called, who look upon him not only as a boss, but also as a role model, and even as a father figure. But write about himself? That's never been in his playbook. Despite all this, his family has pestered him for years to write his story, and the story of Pilot Company, of course. As you will see, not only is his life story a great one, but also has many great stories about his life. Our family has heard most of these stories many times around our family table, and we are excited that Dad has finally relented so that you might enjoy them as well. Before he tells his side of the whole unlikely narrative, let me share a few thoughts as his youngest child. That is one of the people amid his many protests who helped set in motion this whole process of putting his life story into a book. There's a certain story that comes to mind that epitomizes what it's like to have Jim Haslam as a father. When he started Pilot, most of his gas stations were in Southwest Virginia, so Dad constantly had to be there. It had taken every penny he owned or could borrow to build these first stations, and there was certainly no guarantee the company would make it. This meant he was away from home a lot. Yet somehow, in my memory, Dad was always home. I still don't know how he was able to pull this off with his schedule, but the bottom line is that whenever it mattered, Dad was always there. I remember being 7 years old and preparing to play my first peewee baseball game. For whatever reason, it was really important to me that I had my own baseball cleats, not my brother's hand-me-downs. The day before the game, I told Dad that I really needed cleats. To my dismay, he said he had to leave first thing the next morning for Virginia, so Mom would have to get them for me. This wasn't going to work. Moms don't know how to buy baseball cleats. In my 7-year-old brain, this felt like the end of the world. The next day, I was at the ball field before the game, wearing my brother's hand-me-downs, of course. The baseball field was at the bottom of a hill. To this day, one of my most vivid memories is of my dad running full speed down the hill with a shoebox in his hands. I'm sure he blew off some important meeting to make it back in time, and I'm still not sure where he found the time to stop and buy baseball cleats. As a busy executive and father of three, he could have just said, "You're 7. It's a peewee baseball game. You'll be fine." But he figured out a way to show up, and he still does. His children, stepchildren, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren can all tell you their own stories about how he's shown up and loved them well. You will discover throughout the story to come that despite his protests and constantly pushing away the limelight, my dad has accomplished so much in business, the community, and in politics. However, I honestly believe that he never did any of these things for himself. In fact, to understand who Jim Haslam really is as a person, You must understand that everything he has ever done has been done for other people, his family, the university he loves, and the community he feels has given him so much. Over the years, I have had hundreds of people I don't know stop me to tell me of something my dad did for them in secret. In his world, he is never just giving, rather he's always giving back. I've always been a little befuddled when people act as if my dad's efforts in community and political arenas are just Big Jim trying to use his power to pull some strings and get his way. Anyone who actually knows him knows that's not what he is about. He's an offensive lineman, blocking for others to score touchdowns. His natural inclination is to be a team player, sometimes even to a fault. Dad has always found time to invest in relationships, including being there for the people in these relationships. To be honest with you, I can't figure out how he's always found a way to help others so much. I've been in business and have spent time in public office, so I know that time is a difficult commodity to manage, much less manage well. However, it's always seemed that Dad found a way to manage it better than anyone else, always being there to spend time with us. He was always coaching our Little League or sports teams. He was there for talks and trips to the beach. The other kids in the neighborhood would always want to play at our house so Dad could be the quarterback or pitcher for the backyard games. I know how much he was doing in the community, how hard it is to build a business, and how he also somehow maintained a host of really close friendships through it all. Looking back, especially during his 30s and 40s, I still can't figure out how he pulled it all together. And again, in my memory, he was simply always there. There aren't enough words, but suffice to say that having a father who is so loving, hardworking, full of integrity, fun, and optimistic has shaped my entire life. As Dan Fogelberg sang, "My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band." Sometimes I'll be walking down the street and think of something funny that either he did or said, and I will smile all by myself. Well, as you read his story, you'll discover the heart of a remarkable man who is deeply loved and is the reason so many people are smiling. As you turn the page, now it's your turn to smile. And Dad, enjoy the book, even if you really didn't want to write it. Chapter 1, Unexpected Introductions, Burgers, Billionaires, and Big Questions. It was probably just another day to most people, but July 10th, 2017, was one of the most interesting days of my life. At 10 a.m. that summer morning, I was riding up an elevator in a nice but not overly impressive office building in downtown Omaha. Joining me in the elevator were my older son, Jimmy Haslam, investment banker Byron Trott, and a security agent who was escorting our trio to our appointment on the top floor. When the elevator dinged its final ding and the doors opened, we were greeted by the smiling face and warm reception of the man we had traveled all the way from East Tennessee to meet. He extended his hand and said, "Hi, I'm Warren Buffett." Of course, we already knew who he was, so we introduced ourselves, and the famed investor led us to his office. Now, if you know anything about Jimmy Haslam, you know my son tends to jump straight into matters of business. This day was no exception. But Warren interrupted him. "Hold on just a second." Turning to me, he asked, "Jim, how old are you?" "I'm 86 years old." "So am I," he replied with a hint of growing interest, like a man putting a puzzle together piece by piece. "When is your birthday?" "December 13th, 1930. "Really? Mine is August 30th. These days, most people can't remember where they were on September 11th, 2001. It's like a tragic rite of passage in American culture for those old enough to own the memory. But Mr. Buffett had another question altogether. "Where were you on Pearl Harbor Day?" I couldn't help but laugh because there aren't many of us left in this world who have had the sobering yet high honor of answering that particular question. Once we'd gotten to know each other and had talked over some preliminary business matters for about an hour, Warren asked if we were hungry. We were, so we stepped back into the elevator and began heading down toward what I assumed would be a private dining room in the basement of the building, much like the ones we have at our pilot company headquarters back in Knoxville. Instead, the elevator opened into a parking garage. Warren asked me to ride with him in his car and suggested that Jimmy ride with Byron. As we rode along, we began a conversation about philanthropy, something we are both passionate about. I assumed we were going to a country club for lunch, but instead, after about a five-minute drive, we arrived at the Hilton Hotel. We followed Warren through the front doors and into the lobby, where he was greeted left and right by staff members of the hotel. He led us all the way to a corner table in the back section of a little lunch cafe. We took our seats just as a waitress arrived to take our orders. "Hi, Susie," Warren said with a smile. "Hello, Mr. Buffett," she replied. "You want your usual, a cheeseburger and a Coke?" This may have been usual for him, but this whole experience was very unusual for me. There we were sitting at a corner table in a little cafe with the second richest man in the world, and we were about to eat cheeseburgers. But just like most of the people I've crossed paths with over the years, from army privates to company presidents, from small-town businessmen to big-city billionaires, I saw that Warren Buffett is just a regular guy. If anything, I'd say he's actually humbler than most. It's one of the moments you never forget. In fact, in that moment, I found myself yet again asking the question I pondered many times over the course of this incredible life God has granted me. How in the world did this happen? That's a question I aim to address in this book. And though I usually don't drink them, I went ahead and ordered a Coke too. Hey, if it's good enough for Warren Buffett, I guess it's good enough for me. I've been lucky. Mr. Buffett taught me more that day than how to enjoy an ice-cold Coca-Cola. Looking back, I know I took away many other unique and significant impressions from my time with him, just as I have done with so many other incredible people and experiences in my life. Each one has taught me something valuable. Even when the times have been rough, each one has made me a better man, even when it's taken some time to get there. Each one has contributed to my story in remarkable ways. Though it is my name on the cover of the book and my story you're about to hear, it's really the stories of my interactions with others I look forward to sharing the most. This is really our story, not mine. It's true that no man is an island. We're all connected, and these connections are what make any story, including mine, worth its salt. This is the story of my family, our company, and me. While my life has had its share of the ups and downs that all people go through, I've had some unique experiences that my family feels just might leave you entertained, informed, and perhaps even encouraged or inspired. But if nothing else, I hope this is going to be fun. We may not know each other, but as you've traveled down the interstate with your family, perhaps you've stopped for gas, coffee, or food at one of our pilot company locations and interacted with some of our 28,000 incredible team members. Regardless, you might be wondering why I'm writing this book in the first place. There are three main reasons. One, to tell this story for my family and friends. Two, to offer a personal history of Pilot Company from its beginnings in 1958 to the present. Three, to share principles and insights about what I think are really important in this world, things I have discovered, often the hard way, through living a full life beyond what I deserve. Regarding the first reason, you need to know that I'm writing this book under extreme duress, or should I say, at the loving insistence of my wonderful family. For years, they've been not so gently prodding me to write my own story. Penning my own autobiography and memoir was not something I set out to do, nor is it something I ever thought I would do. Certain friends, like the talented and hilarious Coach Rick Barnes, who actually had a dream about me writing this book, have long suggested that I do so, but I've never really considered it until now. Writing your own story has plenty of positives and negatives. From a negative side, it may look like you think your story is important enough to be written, which seems self-serving. The truth is, I do not even have the slightest desire to attempt to wax eloquent about my success and failures. This is not a book where you're going to watch me pat myself on the back. I don't deserve anything of the sort. There are enough self-congratulating books out there, and I do not plan to add mine to the list. But as the story unfolds, there are some people I do want to pat on the back, and I think you'll find they are more than worthy of accolades. The people in my story are the positives of my story: family, friends, mentors, pilot company team members, and how, together, we built the company. There are reasons I have finally...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.